You know, I'm going to be preaching today about the very thing that we did. How about that? That part of the kingdom is learning how to wait on God. You know, your theology can be right, and you can dry up on the vine. If you have your Bibles today, I want to go to Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. And we're going to do a little bit of digging. The conference that we were at last week, and just for the record, I'm glad that this next week is my last conference for the year. I'm about conferenced out. You know, when you have so many things as we have going on and you add that to it, it's a little bit difficult for an old fat man. But how many know I'm getting stronger every day? God has a purpose, and we're going on. And I'm feeling His strength more every day. The more I get into His presence, the stronger that I'm getting. Last week, I had, first time in my life, I ever had a prophetic roar released through me that they were having me sound a shofar over the crowd, and I was actually disappointed. I couldn't get it as loud as I wanted to, you know. And God said, set this down, I'll show you something that's loud, and I found out exactly what can be released. Under there was a holy roar prophetic word that people in the very back of the room said they held up their hand, they felt it resonating in the air. I mean, that's the kind of thing that we need more of. And the only way it can be released is if we learn how to get in, to stay in His presence. And the world doesn't like this. The devil doesn't like this. You can do ministry all day long, but if you don't have a chance to get in His presence, you're just simply beating the air. It's simply words going forth, and there's no transformation. And if we're going to have Jesus as our example, how many know Jesus did more than beat the air? He is beating the God of the air.
Come on.
All right? Isaiah 40, 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. You need to underline that in your Bible. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I love the way the Amplified translates this. But those who wait for the Lord, who expect, look for, and hope in Him, shall change, and renew their strength and their power. They shall lift up their wings and mount up close to God as eagles mounted up to the sun. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint or become tired. One of the reasons that we don't have a lot of change anymore in the body of Christ is we don't have the presence of God to the level that we need in our daily lives and in our corporate lives. This word wait in the Hebrew is kava, Strong's number 6960, which says to wait, to look for, to hope, to expect. To wait, to look eagerly for, I like this, to lie in wait. I'm lying in wait, just waiting for God to show up, and then I'm going to jump right in the middle of it and just stay there. It also means to collect, to bind together. When you are waiting on God, waiting on His presence, it's like the tzitzit on the prayer shawl. You become entwined. In fact, this whole concept of weight and everything is similar to mikvah, that when we baptize, there's this interweaving that goes on in the presence of God. As I was reading through some of the commentaries, I found this one so powerful. It's out of the Tyndale Old Testament commentary on the book of Isaiah. Now listen to this. Now this guy has been touched by God and has got a lot of smarts. You know, I like reading people smarter than I am. That way, when I quote them, what do I sound? I sound really smart, okay? Listen to this. Because he's dealing with Isaiah, he said, there's a string of the attributes of the Lord, eternal, eternity, omnipresent, untiring, strength and wisdom. And now he's talking about in the Hebrew, when you get to this verse, continues in the opening Hebrew participle, he is also one who shares his strength. Not as a whim or an occasional act, but as part of what he is. Oh, I like to come unglued this morning. When I wait on God, that supernatural strength that rocks the heavens, a part of his nature, just like his love, just like his omnipresence, just like his knowledge and his foreknowledge and all that, a part, when you let God be who he is, he imparts strength to you. I like that, not occasionally. Now, why do we get it occasionally? Because it's only occasionally that we get there. You never, ever come into God's presence and not be changed and not be strengthened. And so if you're claiming, Mike, I am not changed, I am not strengthened, then guess where you haven't been? You're not telling on God, you're telling on yourself. Selah. And the only one who can change that part of the equation is you. Those that move in the kingdom must discover how to wait upon the Lord to be continually infused with his strength. And if we have ever needed it before, we need it right now. We need to learn how to get alone with the Almighty. Now let's go to Genesis chapter 3 and verse 8. One of the things that I was blessed by the Huddlestons down there in Lebanon, Tennessee, is they have an absolute passion for the presence of God. And when they start praying and they start worshiping, God shows up because that is their lifestyle. I mean, Susan down there, she's like a 357 magnet for the kingdom of God. She'd get on that keyboard and the simple songs that God gave her. And the presence of God would come in, and Mark would say, you know why she can do that? It's because she spends 4 hours a day in the presence of God. That's what she does. But I want to show you something here, and you have to kind of read and come at it sideways to really see what this is sharing in Genesis 3:8. And it said, they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. You see, Adam and Eve were created. You were created. A part of your spiritual DNA is to fellowship with God, is to be in the presence of God. That every day in the cool of the evening, the Almighty longs to come into fellowship with us. And it was in that communion with Almighty God that Adam and Eve were given the strength to enforce the kingdom in the garden and to do all the kingdom assignments that they were given in the garden. But something happened when they aligned themselves with the Nehesh. They aligned themselves with the kingdom of darkness. Now there is something instinctual at the sin nature level that you hide yourself from the presence of God. Now Tyndale's commentary says really what this is talking about, it is not talking about the voice of God, but the sound of God. That they heard God coming. And they went and they hid themselves. And it literally says that there was an impulse embedded within them to hide themselves from the presence, literally the face of God. Now, if you've understood Hebraic heritage at all, you understand that's significant. Part of the Aaronic blessing is, may your face be upon me. May your face shine upon me, because everything of the kingdom flows when God is looking at you. Our sin has done what? It has hid his face. Our sinful nature runs from the face of God, but a redeemed spirit man wants to run to the face of God. Because it's in His face. Abram, walk thou before me and be thou perfect. I'm going to have this face-to-face relationship with you, Abram, and I'm going to make you into something that you can't be by yourself, because there's something transformative that happens when you're walking before my face. Why was Moses able to do the things that he did? He spoke to God face-to-face as a man would speak with a friend. The New Testament tells us that there is a knowledge, according to the Apostle Paul, that shines in the face of Jesus. Well, why don't we have that knowledge? Because you're not beholding His face. What do you do when you pray? I'm seeking the face of God. Come on. Today, we still have that propensity to hide ourselves from His presence, even among the body of Messiah. We exchange seeking the face of God with worshiptainment. It looks like worship, but it isn't worship. It's all entertainment because it's all about you. How many know that God doesn't need strobe lights, fog machines, all these just crazy things? I have never read in heaven where they turned on the lights and all the electronic equipment and the fog machines, and then God said, well, the party's on. It's not there. All of that is about the flesh. And it doesn't just have to be with the new way that the emergent church and all that is doing worship. Whenever the Hosanna songs, now the old Hosanna songs, I mean, they would bring in the presence of God. And we had the old saints get mad because it wasn't out of the hymnal. Ignoring that the presence of God came in on it because it was about what they wanted, not about what God wanted. But guys, we were created to seek His face. We were created to be in His presence. We were created to have our spiritual batteries charged by fellowshipping with Him. And I don't care how much you go to church. I don't care. Unless you learn to do this, you're never going to have your batteries charged. You're never going to fulfilled. You're never going to move beyond the miserability of where you are now. No man can bring it to you. No minister can bring it to you. Nobody can bring it to you. It's something that you've got to seek yourself. Let's go to Mark chapter 6. Now, Mary and I can kind of relate to this one after doing some of the conferences that we've been at. You know, I told Mary when I went down to the Prophecy Watchers conference down in Colorado Springs, I kind of enjoyed it the first couple of days because nobody knew who I was. I was in basically incognito. I could go down there and eat breakfast and just enjoy myself and tell you, there were a few people that knew her. Well, there were some students down there and podcast listeners. But for the most part, nobody knew who I was. After I spoke a couple of times, that all of a sudden there was this interesting thing happened. It took 3.5 hours to have breakfast. I never got a warm breakfast. It was not only cold, man. There were penguins looking at my eggs going, ugh. It was that cold. And I watched some of the other speakers. And when it would come lunchtime, they weren't going to the restaurant. They were scurrying up to their room and using phones and using room service. And by the last day, I thought, you know what? That is really a good idea. And so I went up there and just quiet. Nothing going on. And just sat in my room and I'm starting to go, oh, that was one of the most wonderful burgers and fries I had ever had in my life. Just sitting there in the quiet. Just me and God. I was thanking Him for all that He had done and all the excitement I was seeing and all the people and everything else. But it's like, oh, I like this. Nobody knows my room number. Hallelujah. Did you find Mark 6:30 yet? And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus, and He told them all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And He said to them, come ye yourselves apart in a desert place and rest for a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. Been there, done that, bought that t-shirt. But listen. When Jesus is our example, now he would go and he would pray and he'd come back. We always see him going in desert places to pray. He prayed all night before he even selected the 12, even though he was Almighty God come in the flesh. Well, why was he doing that? For our example. But even when do we realize what was going on when the disciples gathered by themselves with him? Who was he? They were communing with God. They were being taught by God. And as he would teach them privately, they could leave there and go cast out devils and then come back astonished saying, Lord, this is awesome. Even the demons obey when we do stuff in your name. Why were they able to do that? Because he did some little, he laid hands on them and did some little ceremony? No, they spent time with him. They were charging up. They were drawing from his strength and his kingdom and his purpose and his power so that when they left his presence, they had stayed there long enough to bring the kingdom with them. When we were doing, Mary and I were on Hagman and Hagman this last week, I guess the devil kind of knew what was going on because there was a Windows update that wreaked havoc with every single Windows computer that we had, and to include the studio computer. When we got on and actually, their voices was coming out of the computer speakers instead of the headphones. Well, that doesn't work when you're in a studio. You're wearing headphones with professional mics, and kind of aggravating just a little bit. We weren't really on our A game because of technical difficulties. But you know what the heart of the remnant is? I don't care if I'm in the fivefold ministry or not. I'm going to get lost in his presence because that is a part of who I was created to be. And in that presence, I find wholeness. And then I leave my prayer chamber not looking for a fix, but moving out in power because I've been fixed by what I got when I was in his presence. Oh, being with Jesus changes you. It never changes him. Now in Acts 4:13, I want you to notice what is said of Peter and John. Now these are uneducated men as far as the Sanhedrin would be concerned. You look at people like Rabbi Shaul or the Apostle Paul, and he was a graduate of the school of Hillel. He basically had a double PhD. And then you have these guys coming on the scene that were quite articulate with depth of knowledge and moved in power. In verse 13, and now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Let me tell you something. I've had a lot of students that have went to Biblical Life College and Seminary and have walked away disappointed. You know why? Because it only works when you've been with Jesus. Come on now. All the head knowledge isn't going to matter that much if you aren't with Jesus in the process. Now, Jesus in the process, it becomes education on steroids. And God begins to open up the secrets of the universe to you. And you're not just going through stuff to get a grade. You're being transformed in the whole process because it's Jesus. Are you being with Jesus? If you haven't been with Jesus, if you haven't spent that time before the throne and seeking his face, you have nothing to give in your hands. I mean, no, the devil's not impressed if you can parse the Greek and the Hebrew. What he's impressed with is the power of God when he comes around you and you start speaking and it parts his hair before you even get to say, cast, you know, come out. How many know the enemy's not a fool? They're not blind to these things. You can be all puffed up here and have nothing here. But you can be an old country boy with not a lot up here, just that what God said is true, and that when I come on the scene, because God's in me and I'm walking with Him, when I say get out, you got to go. How many know hell recognizes that very, very quickly? Now I want you to go to Luke chapter 18. In fact, 18:1 you need to underline in your Bible. It said, He spake a parable unto them to this end. I like what Luke does. He says, I'm going to give you the parable, but just in case you really don't get it, I'm going to give you the punchline of the parable before I give you the parable. That men ought always to pray and to not faint. So as we read this, this is the subject of this parable that Jesus is teaching on, saying that there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded men. And there was a widow in the city, and that she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine enemies. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said unto himself, though I fear not God, nor regard men, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avengeth his own elect, which crieth day and night unto him? Though he bear long with them, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Underline that in your Bible. We're getting ready to get some speedily a coming. It's when this remnant ministry begins to move in the kingdom and move forward. But listen to the last part here. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? When Jesus comes, will he find those that have given up on praying? You see, there's sometimes when we pray for something. If you knew what had to be positioned, because Mary and I are believing for some big stuff to include the bringing down of mind control. Right now, because I have seen as we begin praying this, if God did it immediately the day that we did it without doing some other things, nations to include this one would have toppled. How many know that I don't want that prayer answered and then having to live scenes out of The Road Warrior with Mel Gibson? Okay, I don't want that. And so God knows what I'm praying and what I really mean when I pray it. But he says there's going to be times that you feel like you're dealing with this judge that's not really hearing you, because there's certain things that have got to be set in motion. Now for myself, what I have found is that when I begin praying certain things, why there is a delay is not so much God changing the circumstances. He's got to make me into the man that can walk in it. There are some things that I have been praying for over 30 years that I am just now getting in the ability to walk in. Now, the rest of the world is just going to have to hold on because I'm there. But it's taken God that long. But what would have happened if I'd have gave up? I do not want to get to heaven with the should have been, could have been, but if only. How many know that you can't take any of those things and throw them as a crown at His feet? Them are air castle crowns. But that which He really accomplished, because I spent the time in His Word and in His presence for Him to build and to mold something in me, and that as I was waiting, I was changed and charged. Oh, you need to write that down. In His presence, I am changed and charged, and you can only get charged to the same proportion that you are changed. That one was not in my notes. So if you're not getting charged, it's because you've not done any changing. Yeah, I know what you're saying. We need to quit having you go on these conferences. You're getting a little too wired up, fired up. You ain't seen nothing yet. Wait till I begin my next book that we're going to publish ourselves. You see, I was challenged when Russ Dizdar was there talking about how that these warlocks were writing documents like the Slender Man, that how that the very words on the page were demonically charged. And I'm sitting there listening to that, and I'm saying, well, you know what, Father? Then the words that I write down in my books, they can be Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled, kingdom-charged, to where I want the UPS guy, when he picks up the box to deliver it, saying, there's something different about this book in this box. That's what I want. And I'm going to start every day that when I write on this new book, I'm starting it out by getting on my face. And then when he starts talking, I start writing. I want to take this thing up to a whole nother level. Because if he's going to find faith on earth, it's going to be right here. Now this word faith, he said, I want you to always pray and not faint. I heard one famous preacher saying, well, you know, there's one translation says turn coward. That's not what this means at all. Faint in the Greek means to be utterly spiritless, to be wearied out or exhausted. When I come, if men have given up on prayer, they're going to be exhausted. There was a time and a times in which he was given power to battle against the saints, to wear out the saints. Maybe in the battle they forgot about the power of praying and staying before the face of God. They got so busy trying to counter his attacks, they weren't going and doing what they needed to counter his attacks. Selah. But you know, things in the Word of God come in full circle. We have the Nehesh, the flaming serpent, the seraph that set the tree on fire of knowledge that Adam and Eve were drawn to, promising them illumination. And so God responds by setting a little bush on fire and said, Moses, Moses. Then Jesus comes along and says, if I be lifted high, and it was a cross, and I know there's out there, well, it was actually a tree, it wasn't a cross. Well, that's a Jewish idiom for the cross. But why did they keep on calling it the tree? Because it started in a tree. The cross was a fashioned tree prepared for the Son of God to be lifted up on, just like the Nehesh was, and he didn't need fire to draw men to it. But yet on the day of Pentecost, what fell? Okay, so there's a lot of things that come full circle. Matthew 26, 36. We see Jesus came to a place called Gethsemane. What was Gethsemane? I come to the garden alone. The garden of Gethsemane. You know, Jesus could have went anywhere to pray. Why did he end up in a garden? Because Adam fell in a garden. In the hour of temptation, Adam fell in a garden amongst trees. Now the hour has come. The pivotal moment of temptation like he has never known. He began to feel our inclination. You see, it was in the garden where he began to feel the iniquity. He began to feel our sin nature, even then was beginning to come on him. And it did so in a garden before he was lifted up on the tree. Then cometh Jesus unto them into a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto his disciples, set ye here, and while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. How many know if he felt the junk that was our nature on him, he would feel very heavy? Sorrowful. Then he saith unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and praying, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto his disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. He came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. We've come full circle. The scripture says that this battle was so great, the struggle was so great, that the capillaries begin to break in his face and he began to sweat blood. That is how heavy this was. And, you know, it wasn't that way with Adam in the garden. It was kind of an exaltation. I will make you be gods. All you have to do is follow me. There wasn't a real struggle, but Adam fell, didn't he? In a garden. Now Almighty God come in the flesh as the second Adam. He is feeling our rebellion. He is feeling our sin. He is feeling that inclination from us to run from the face of God. And he doesn't run. He bows and he says, Not my will, but thine be done. You need to understand that it was there that he was infused with the strength and the power to endure the cross. Come on. We need to understand that the nails did not hold the Son of God on the cross. His determination to finish the work held him there. You see, he's our example. In the end times, before he comes back, how many know it's going to get rough? What's our example? We better learn how to have that garden experience and fall at the feet of the Father and say, I'm not leaving here. I'm not leaving here until I see to it that your will is done, that I completely surrender to your perfect will. That's the remnant. Now, the one I forgot to add, I'm out of paper, the one I forgot to add, I'm going to throw it up on the screen when we edit the video. When Jesus said, you know, you go forth and you are to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, you need to read that out of the complete Jewish Bible. They read that down there at the conference, and I like to have had a cow. Because Dr. Stern, understanding our Hebraic heritage, being a Jewish scholar, translated it this way. Baptize them into the reality of the Father. Baptize them into the reality of the Son. And baptize them into the reality of the Holy Ghost. I liked to come unglued. There is a reality to Almighty God that only comes by learning to practice the presence of God and come into His presence. I like what Dr. Michael Heiser says. In fact, I think he wrote a book about it. He said, I dare you to bore me with anything that's in this. I dare you to bore me. I tell you what, when I come out of the presence of God, I just get in the book of Judges and, you know, Jimmy Joe begat Freddie Doo or whatever, you know, and I just get excited because I start connecting the dots. You can get blessed by the begats because you begin to see how God builds a godly line, and that how they go forth and do things, or how that even in a line that it was loser, 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 somebody gets on their face before God, and well, God changed that line, didn't He? Come on now. Well, some of you are going to get that for a second. Well, if I just come from the right family, honey, there ain't been a right family since Adam and Eve. They were right, and then they got all wrong. And all of us sprang out of the wrongness. It's not what family you came from, but what family you were adopted into. And the only way to become more like your new daddy is spend time with him. Spend time with him. Get in here, find out what he likes. And you know, people, you know, keep on arguing, but Mike, do I really have to give up pork? No, you don't. But if you have a heart to please the Father, you will. It's not a salvific issue. It's a getting closer to daddy issue. Because there was a time in my life I thought the guy who invented the spiral ham ought to have a Nobel Peace Prize or something out of that thing. I thought it was the greatest thing. That and potato doo-dah, and you got one fat, happy preacher out dancing. He used to be. But you know what I found out? My daddy said, don't eat it. And so I had this choice. Who do I love more? Father God or the ham? Or the bacon? Or the crunchy golden shrimp that they serve at Long John Silver? Well, you know, Mike, if it tastes, you know, why, if it's bad for me, why does it taste so good? Because it's just like sin. It can taste real good, but look what it does to you. Now we're finding out that shellfish and pork does all kinds of things. When I went through naturopathic school, and these were secular people, some of the books that I was reading, the first thing they tell you is do not eat pork. Because not only do you have the parasite issue, it digests so quickly it destroys all the nutrients in the meal that you just ate. All you get is the calories out of it. See, our daddy wants us to be healthy. Then when I found out it's holy in occult circles, and it can contain demonic presence. Woo! I will go the rest of my life and I will never willfully ever eat that stuff again because my daddy said no. And no matter, even if every once in a while that my flesh may want it, I crucify that desire just like I crucify the desire for any sin the devil tries to tempt me with or anything else. A God has a no list and I say no to the no list and I always say yes to his yes list. And every time I do, and the Father watches us, guys. When your flesh wants to, and you crucify the flesh because you're obedient to God, God says, that is how you show me you love me. And that has been a consistent theme from Genesis all the way to the book of Revelation. We show him our love by our obedience. If you have a love that you're proclaiming that does not require obedience to God, then you are putting forth a false love. It's not God's definition. It is a carnal definition of love that lets you get away with whatever your flesh wants to because you won't submit to the one who gave his all to save your soul. But as I get into his presence, we need to have a fresh baptism. That's one of the things, ever since they did that every day, now I'm praying, Lord, baptize me into the reality of you. And as I was praying that, I got a new album from Casting Crowns. And they got one, it's called, you know, Why Am I Holding Back? You call me to move mountains and I'm sitting here playing in the sand. You call me to deeper waters, but I've settled for the shallow end. What would happen if I gave it all? I remember I brought that up on my phone going home one night and almost drove off the road, man. I'll give it all. I give it all because I want to know what it's like to move a mountain. I want to know what it's like out in the deep waters of God. I want to know what it's like to walk in a room and have demons cry out saying, oh, you've come to trouble me. You bet your bippy I have. Not only have I come to trouble you, I've come to cast you out. Come on now. There's so much more to the kingdom. There's so much more available to us. And it is only found by getting in his presence and waiting on him. Abiding in him. Only when we abide can we draw from the vine. You got to abide to draw. It's time to get thirsty. I'm thirsty for his presence. I'm thirsty for his fire. I feel like right now everything that we have done up to ministry so far is not even the tithe of the possibility of what we're getting ready to do. I'm excited. But it's going to be like the Apostle Paul. It's not going to be me because I died, but it's Christ living in me. And I want him to get a lot done. There's a lot still to be written. There's a lot to be taught. There are a lot of lives to be touched. And if I'll just simply, and if you'll just simply get into his presence, it'll get done. Many of us have been having these things we've been believing God for a long time. And it seems like we're dealing with that unjust judge. And I'm here to tell you the only reason that there has been a delay is you've not spent enough time waiting on him. It'll turn the job around. It'll turn the family around. It'll turn the physical condition around. It'll turn everything around. Because the longer that I stay with him, the more it begins to saturate me all the way down to the DNA level. You can't get so full of God and then the devil causes you problems. Come on. God's calling us to a higher level, kingdom level. Man, that's what I want. I hunger, I thirst for that. And I'm not going to be satisfied until I see it done and maintained. And so there'll be a lot of times people maybe want ministry and want me to do this, that, and the other, and I'm about ready to put a kibosh on some of it saying, I've got to have time with him or all this is worthless. Once I get this done, then we can do all this. But I've been feeling this frustration that I'm so busy doing all this, I don't have time for the other, and I'm going to have to change some things. Because I'm not going to tell God no. I'll tell you no all day long. Come on. But I'm not going to tell God no. Because it's only in his presence that I can get your yes. It's only in his presence that you can get your yes. We got to learn how to abide and how to wait on him. That's the secret to the kingdom. That's the secret of one of the things Jesus came to bring us, is abiding in him. Well, Father, I ask right now in the name of Jesus that you would loose a fire and a desire on the inside of us to seek your face. Father, to bust out of this contemporary Christianity that has no power, it's all flash and no show, and no power is just flash and show, and it's all about the flesh, Father. We desire something more. We desire you. We desire your presence. And Father, I ask that our prayer closet would become the most used part of our life. That as an act of our will and an act of faith, we're going to turn the world off for a while just so that we can spend time with you. And Father, in that waiting, just like it says in the Hebrew, we are going to be changed and we are going to be strengthened as we spend time with our Heavenly Father. And Father, we just ask, Holy Spirit, do whatever you got to do. Change whatever you got to change. Help us rework our priorities to make that a passion. And we thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name.